بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. ثم أما بعد، الحمد لله. We continue going over the tremendous book Al-Qawa'id Al-Arba' by the Imam, the Mujaddid, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, reading from the translation, or Afwan, reading from the explanation of the Fadil to Sheikh Al-Allama, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, Hafidhullahu Ta'ala. We were under the discussion of the portion of the book in which the Imam, the Mujaddid Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْعِبَادَ لَا تُسَمَّ الْعِبَادَ إِلَّا مَعَ التَّوْحِيدِ كَمَا أَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ لَا تُسَمَّ صَلَاةً إِلَّا مَعَ الطَّهَارَةِ. That, and know, have knowledge, that worship is not considered nor called worship unless it is coupled with tawheed. Just as the prayer is not considered or called the prayer unless it has with it a tahara, purity. Al-Allama Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, hafidhahullahu ta'ala, he goes on in his discussion on this particular portion to explain the conditions for the acceptance of deeds. The conditions for the acceptance of deeds. And the Shaykh, he says that those conditions, they are sharutan. They are sharutan. There are two conditions. Two conditions. The Shaykh, he mentions, he says, إِذَا اخْتَلَّ شَرُطٌ مِنَ الشَّرُطَيْنِ بُطِلَتْ. He says, if one of the two conditions is missing, then it is invalid, meaning the action will subsequently be invalid. It will not count. Naam. And we briefly mentioned these conditions in the last class, but we wanted to go into a bit more detail, as we mentioned them at the very end. We wanted to go into more detail, so we left it there, and we pick up from right now, inshallah ta'ala. The Shaykh, he mentions, he says, شَرْطُ الْأَوَّلِ, the first condition, أَن تَكُونَ خَالِصًا لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَيْسَ فِيهَا شِرْكٌ. He said it has to be sincere for the face of Allah, and it does not have therein shirk. There is no shirk. There's no polytheism or associating of partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mixed inside of this action. فَإِنْ خَالَطَّهَا شِرْكٌ And if shirk enters into it, بطلت, it becomes invalid. If shirk were to mix into an action, then that action subsequently will become null and void. It will not count. Naam. So the Shaykh, he says, فَإِنْ خَالَطَّهَا شِرْكٌ وطلت هذا he said الشيخ he said مثل الطهارة and this is like طهارة إذا خالطها حدث بطلت he said just like طهارة if it is mixed with that which will invalidate and break the طهارة then the طهارة it is null and void it goes away If that which will break the wudu enters upon the wudu, then the wudu, it goes away. It's no longer there. Right? Likewise, the action, if shirk comes inside of an action, then it will destroy that action. And subsequently, the action will be null and void. It will be null and void. The Shaykh says, كَذَلِكَ Likewise, إِذَا عَبَدْتَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَشْرَكْتَ بِهِ بَطَلَتْ عِبَادَتُكْ He says that if you were to worship Allah, and then you were to make shirk with Allah, then your ibadah will be null and void. Then your ibadah, it will be null and void. It won't count. وَهَذَا شَرُطُ الْأَوَّلِ And this is the first condition. This is the first condition. Naam. As we mentioned, inside of the Deen of Al-Islam, we have to have proofs and evidences. Naam. And the Shaykh Fawzan, hafidhullahu ta'ala, he has a beautiful khutbah on this very topic, wherein he mentions much proofs and much evidence for this particular affair. بإذن الله تعالى we will mention from the proofs and evidences and what the Shaykh he mentions inside of this particular khutbah and as can be found in other places and بإذن الله تعالى we will give you those reference points. على كل حال with regards to the first condition, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He informs us inside of His noble book, the reason for which He created the human beings. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ And I did not create the jinn nor the mankind except for them to worship me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He informs us that we have been created to worship Him, Jalla wa'ala, and to worship Him alone. And to not associate any partners with Allah, Jalla wa'ala, but to worship Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Naam. So when one reflects upon this, then he will realize that if they were to associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside of a particular action, then that action subsequently will be that which has not reached nor fulfilled the purpose for which they were created. So, likewise, it is not hard to understand that that action will not count. It will be null and it will be void. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also says in His noble book, as could be found in Surah Al-Bayyinah, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ حُنَفَاءَ And they were not commanded except to worship Allah alone, making all of the religion sincere for Him. This ayah can be found in Surah Al-Bayyinah, But what we need for one of the sisters to provide for us the number of the ayah. We need one of the sisters to provide for us the number of the ayah. Now, hayakumullah. طيب. And when you look at this ayah, as Shaykh Fawzan, hamdallahu ta'ala, he commands, as he informs us, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, he commands us with a command. Allah ta'ala, he says, وَمَا أُمِرُوا. And they were not ordered, they were not commanded. Naam. So we understand from this particular point that the deen of al-Islam is by the command, is by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, Allah ta'ala, he commands us with what? With at-tawheed. Allah ta'ala, he says, فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. And have knowledge and know that nothing has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah. Naam. And know that nothing has the right to be worshipped in truth except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ala kulli hal, inside of these verses, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has commanded the people to establish the tawheed. To establish the tawheed. So every deed that we do, it has to have therein sincerity if we want for it to count. And if that sincerity is missing, then that deed, it will not count. From that which points us to the fact that we have to have a pure intention is the hadith that has been narrated in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. And it is that famous hadith which is إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, that verily actions are but by their intentions. As we said, أَخْرَجَهُ الْبُخَارِي وَمُسْلِمُ. It's been collected by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. In the first few classes, or early on in this series, we had mentioned that Imam al-Wadi'i Muqbil bin Hadi rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions that at the bare minimum, one should know from a hadith is who narrated that hadith, the text of the hadith, and where the hadith is collected. Naam. Again, at the bare minimum, we should know the narrator of the hadith, where the hadith is collected, and the text of the hadith itself. So for this particular hadith, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ, we said, أَخْرَجُهُ الْبُخَارِي وَمُسْلَمُ حَدِيثٌ مُتَفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ, that it has been collected by al-Bukhari and Muslim. نعم. So this particular mention here, that it has been collected by al-Bukhari and Muslim, and the hadith is مُتَفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ, then this is one of the three things that Sheikh Muqbil, rahimahullahu ta'ala, Imam al-Wadi'i, he says that we have to know at least the minimum. Naam, we memorize a hadith, at the minimum we shall have this information. طيب. And then there's the text of the hadith. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Right? To the end of the hadith. So we have the text. So we're missing one of the three things that Imam al-Wadi'i, he said, at bare minimum, we should know. And that is the narrator of the hadith. Right? And as we said, this hadith is a hadith that is famous. And we want everyone inside of the class to memorize this hadith. This hadith is the first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. The first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari is this hadith. So if someone asks you, what is the first hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari? Then which hadith is it? It is this hadith. إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. طيب. If one person is looking for it, they can also find it. It is the first hadith inside of أَرْبَعِينَ النَّوَّيَّ. It is the first hadith in the Matn of أَرْبَعِينَ النَّوَّيَّ. In the text of the 40 hadith by Imam Nawawi. نعم. So one is looking for this hadith, so memorize it. Then they can find it inside of the 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi. So now the question now for you sisters is, who is the narrator of this hadith? Who was the narrator of this hadith? Na'am, ahsantum. It is narrated on the authority of Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Na'am. Tayyib. This particular hadith, the Prophet sallam, he said, as Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he narrates that the Prophet sallam, he said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى فَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِلدُّنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ امْرَأَةً يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجَرَ إِلَيْهِ. The Prophet ﷺ said, what means, and actions are but by their intentions, and everyone shall be rewarded for that which they have intended. So whoever has made his hijrah to Allah and His Messenger, then his hijrah is to Allah and His Messenger. And whoever has made hijrah for the dunya, to gain something from the worldly affairs, or for a woman in order to marry her, then his hijrah is unto that in which he had made the hijrah to. Inside of this particular hadith, it becomes clear that an individual will only be rewarded based upon what he intended. Naam. And we see that in the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَى. That actions are but by their intentions, and everyone will be rewarded based upon what they intended. So we understand from that they will be rewarded or not rewarded based upon what they intended. طيب. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, after explaining this principle, he gave to us an example, right, to show us the application and how this principle is applied. He says, so therefore, the one who has made hijrah unto Allah and His Messenger, right, meaning his intention, his qasd, that he made the hijrah for, was for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He had ikhlas. Then, his hijrah is to Allah and His Messenger, meaning he will be rewarded for his hijrah. He will be rewarded for his hijrah because he had what? Why will he be rewarded for his hijrah? Because he had what? I'm asking you all now. It's because he had what? Ikhlas. Naam, ahsant. It's because he had ikhlas. So therefore he's rewarded. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he gives an example, right, of the one who is not rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his hijrah. So he says, وَمَنْ كَانَتْ هِجْرَتُهُ لِلدُّنْيَا يُصِيبُهَا أَوْ امْرَأَةً يَنْكِحُهَا فَهِجْرَتُهُ إِلَى مَا هَاجْرَ إِلَيْهِ. And whoever his hijrah was for a worldly gain, or was for a woman in order to marry her, then his hijrah was until that which he made his hijrah to. Meaning that what? That the reward for him will be whatever with that he made his hijrah to, but he has no reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has no reward. Why he has no reward? Because he did not have what? He did not have ikhlas. Naam. Sentum. Because he did not have ikhlas. So therefore he gets no reward. Tayyib. Imam Ibn Rajab, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions a very important point and note on this particular hadith that I want you all to write down, and I want you to put a star, asterisk, or what have you, highlight next to it, because it's very important. He says, Imam Ibn Rajab, he says, هذا الحديث, this hadith, ميزان لأعمال في باطنها. He said that this hadith is a scale for the actions internally. This hadith, this is the scale for the actions for the internally. Naam, so that internally we have to have what? Ikhlas. Internally we have to have ikhlas. طيب. Because if the ikhlas is not there, if the sincerity is not there, then the deed won't count. It won't count. From the proofs, was also show us this, that if shirk mixes with an action, then that action does not count, is Allah Ta'ala's statement, وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And this can be found in Surah Al-An'am, and it's verse 88, where Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, He says what means, and if they make shirk, then those deeds in which they had done before will be rendered null and void. And if they were to make shirk, then the deeds in which they had previously done will be made null and void. They won't count. Why won't it count? Because they make shirk. So it won't count. Another proof and evidence which points us to this is that which comes in Surah Az-Zumar, and it's verse 65, where Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, He says, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَّا الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَا تَكُنَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And verily it has been revealed to you, as it was revealed to those who came before you, that if you make shirk, then verily, most definitely, undoubtedly, your deeds will be rendered null and void. And then verily, most definitely, undoubtedly, you will be from the losers. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, He tells us here in this ayah in Surah Zumar, Na'am, in this ayah number 65, that if an individual makes shirk, then his deeds will be rendered null and void. They will not count. And verily, most definitely, he will be from the losers. He will be from the losers. Naam. So it's clear that if the ikhlas is not there, then the deed is not there. The deed is done. The second condition is al-mutaba'ah. Al-mutaba'ah al-rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second condition is that it has to be in following the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Has to be in accordance to the Sunnah of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَقَالَ الشَّيْخ فَوْزَان حَفِظَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَأَيِّ عِبَادَةٍ لَمْ يَأْتِي بِهَا الرَّسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ فَإِنَّهَا بَاطِلَةٌ مَرْفُوضَةٌ. He says, so any act of worship that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not come with, then it will be erroneous, null and void, and rejected. It will not count. It will not count. The Shaykh, he says, لِأَنَّهَا بِدْعَةٌ خُرَافَةٌ وَخُرَافَةٌ. Because it is bid'ah, and it is a superstitiously based and founded act. So it is rejected. Due to the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. That whoever does an action that does not have on it our command, then it is rejected. Whoever does an action of bid'ah, right, and it does not have on it our command, then it's rejected. In another narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ رَدٌّ. That whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it, then it is rejected. Whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it, then it is rejected. طيب. This hadith, it can be found in Arba'een al-Nawawiyya, in the 40 hadith of Imam al-Nawawi. And therein it is numbered as number 5, right? Both of these hadith, we had given to you the text of the hadith. من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد وقوله صلى الله عليه وسلم من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. نعم, we've given to you the text of the hadith. As far as the first hadith, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. Whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it, then it will be rejected. طيب, who is the narrator of this hadith? Who narrated this hadith? نعم, أحسنتم. Our mother Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها. طيب, this first hadith that we mentioned, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه, to the end of it, where is this hadith collected? Where can we find this hadith? And I don't mean 40 hadith. Where can we find this hadith other than inside of 40 hadith? Al-Bukhari? طيب. Where else? Al-Bukhari and where else? And Muslim. Naam. This hadith is collected in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. And a hadith that is collected in both Al-Bukhari and Muslim is called what? What's it called? Mutafiqun alayh. Naam, ahsantun. طيب. And then the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد. And whoever does an action does not have on it our fear and is rejected. Where is this hadith collected? It's collected where? Other than 40 hadith. Where can we find it? Inside of Muslim. Naam. And a hadith is on the, from the narration of who? Who narrated? Who narrated this hadith? The second one? No one? طيب, it was also narrated by our mother Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها. طيب, she narrated both of these hadith. خير, Imam al-Nawawi, briefly, Imam al-Nawawi, he brings both of these hadith, right? There's a wisdom why he brings both narrations. There's a wisdom. If one looks at the first narration, he finds that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, whoever introduces into this affair of ours that which is not from it, then it is rejected. So this particular hadith is speaking specifically about the one who has initiated and he has invented the bid'ah. The one who invented the bid'ah, then it's rejected, right? It's rejected for the one who invented it. But people, they may misunderstand. And they may think that if you invent a bid'ah, then that's not good. And it's rejected. However, if you just happen to follow someone else and what they had done, then you might be able to get a pass. You might be able to get a pass. So a person comes and he says, I didn't invent the bid'ah. Because you see the narration, it says, من أحدث في أمرنا هذا. Right? Whoever introduces into this affair of ours. And a person may come and he say, well, technically, I didn't introduce it. I didn't make it up. I'm just doing it. You see? I'm just doing it. And like we mentioned before, the ulama, they are very precise in their wording. Right? They're very precise in the selection of words in which they use. And when you find that the ulama have made a book where the ulama have hadith and they have brought the hadith, they bring those hadith in an order for a reason. You understand? They bring these hadith in an order for a reason. There's a reason in the ordering of the hadith. and why they bring this hadith is number one, this one is number two, this one is three, four, five, like this. Now, for a reason. So you find that Imam An-Nawawi, for this reason, this tremendous reason, he didn't suffice as listing as the fifth hadith, just that hadith on our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha that has been collected by Bukhari and Muslim, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha, whoever introduces into this affair of ours, to the end of the hadith. But rather he also brings with it the other narration. Why? Because the other narration, it closes the door on this doubt. So a person, he comes and he says, but I didn't introduce the hadith, I didn't introduce this action, I'm just acting in accordance to it. I didn't make it up. I'm just acting in accordance to that which is contrary to the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So therefore, because of my good intention, I should get a pass, right? No. What's the dalil? The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa raddun. Whoever does an action, whoever performs an action that does not have on it our command, that it is rejected. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he closed the door on both of these situations. And likewise, you find the ulama of hadith, the ulama hum al-warathatul anbiya, and the ulama, they are what? They are the inheritors of the prophets. They also conveyed what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in this particular affair to what? To close the door on anyone who tries to come with something other than the sunnah. So whether you invented it or you're just following that which was invented, it doesn't matter. It doesn't count. Period. Based upon what? On these two narrations from our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Does not count. So you find it's done. So Imam Ibn Rajab, he mentions a very important point that, again, I want you to put an asterisk by and or star, yani highlight, underline, and the like. With the Shaykh, he mentions, he says, هذا الحديث, this hadith, ميزان لأعمال في ظاهرها, that this hadith is a scale for the actions upon their apparentness, in their apparentness, or for the outward actions. It's a mizan for the outward actions. You see, the first hadith, إنما الأعمال بالنيات, was a hadith that was a mizan for the internal actions, whereas this one is a mizan for the external actions. So the internal actions have to be upon ikhlas, and the external actions have to be upon sawaba. They have to be sawaban in accordance to the sunnah of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. والدليل على شرطين مجتمعين قوله تعالى. And the proof for these two conditions together is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه, and whoever he is looking forward to the meeting with his Lord. Whoever is looking forward in hope and anticipating of the meeting of his Lord. Naam. And just as a heads up, I want you sisters to listen well, because I want you to tell me where this ayah can be found, chapter and number. Allah Ta'ala, he says, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا. And whoever he's looking forward and anticipating the meeting with his Lord, then let him work righteous good deeds. Let him work righteous good deeds. And any righteous good deed, that deed will be correct. Sawaban. And in order for a deed to be correct, then that deed has to be what? Has to be upon the sunnah of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this particular portion of the ayah, then it is a dalil for the fact that the deed has to coincide with the sunnah. And then Allah Ta'ala, He says, وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا, and he does not associate any partners in the worship of his Lord. He does not associate any partners in the worship of his Lord. So this here, the second portion, then this is a dalil for the category or the condition of ikhlas. And it has to have ikhlas. Na'am. طيب. وقال إمام ابن كثير, إمام ابن كثير, he says about this ayah, وأحسنتم, which can be found inside of Surah Kahf. And it is the last ayah. The last ayah inside of Surah Kahf. Naam. And what number is the last ayah? Naam. It's 110. طيب. Imam Ibn Kathir, he says, وَهَذَانِ الشَّرْطَانِ. And I want to just take a pause. Yani, you see the ulama, and the, yani, subhanAllah, the understanding of the ulama. How many of us have read Surah Kahf? How many times, right? And maybe we did not see and realize that this particular ayah was a dalil for both conditions for the acceptance of deeds. You understand? See, the ulama, because of the knowledge and the insight and the wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has blessed them with, they see what we don't see, even when we're looking at the same thing. You understand? They see what we don't see, even when we are looking at the same thing. Because we may have seen this ayah, memorized this ayah, recite this ayah much, but didn't realize that this is a dalil for the conditions of the acceptance of the deed, both there and one ayah. And we didn't realize that. But Imam Ibn Kathir, the great alim, he's explaining, commenting on this ayah, he says, وَهَذَانِ الشَّرْطَانِ لَا يَصِحُّ الْعَمَلْ عَامِلْ بِدُونِهِمَا. He said, in these conditions, right, that are contained in this ayah, from being upon ikhlas and being upon sawaba, yani following the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said that an action is not accepted from the one who performs that action without them. He said, "A yakuna khalisan sawaban." He said, meaning it has to be sincere for Allah. Is what it means. Khalisan sawaban. Sawaban. Correct. Has to be sincere for Allah and it has to be correct. طيب. Has to be sincere for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it has to be correct. The ulama, as a side point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us inside of His noble book, Allah ta'ala, He says, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبَلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. The one who created the death and who created life so as to test you, which one of you is best indeed. When they ask the ulama, what is the meaning of best indeed? They say that the deed has to be خَالِصًا صَوَابًا. It has to be sincere for Allah, and it has to be sawaban. It has to be sincere and it has to be sawaban, correct. And I want you to understand though, this is why we here. So don't think that the human being has been put on earth to do bid'ah. No. We've been put here and a part of it, we're being tested to see which of our deeds is best. What deed is the deed that's best? The deed that's sincere and is sawaban. Is khalisan sawaban. That's, and I want you to understand that point. And this too will give you another understanding of the repugnant nature of bid'ah. Of the repugnant nature of bid'ah. Ala kulli hal. What does it mean, khalisan? Imam Kathir explains. He says, wal khalis an yakuna lillah. It is sincere if it is for Allah. If it is for Allah Ta'ala, it's sincere. طيب. والصواب. What does it mean, صواب? That is correct. What does that mean, correct? Imam Ibn Kathir, he says, أن يكون متابعا للشريعة. He said it has to be correct, meaning that it is that which is following the Sharia. It coincides with the Sharia. And we got the Sharia from where? From Nabi. It's from the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So it's that which has to be what? in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, in accordance to that which the Prophet ﷺ came with, that message that he conveyed to us from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it has to be in accordance to the sunnah of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is what it means, sawaba. This is what it means, sawaba. Correct. Correct meaning what? In accordance to the sunnah. So correct, it means what, sisters? What does it mean? Correct, it means what? Finish the sentence, inshallah, time. In the type box there. According to the sunnah. Naam. Tayyib. The Imam, he goes on and he says, فَيَسِحُّ ظَاهِرُهُ بِالْمُتَابَعَ وَبَاطِنُهُ بِالْإِخْلَاصِ. So the external action, the apparentness of it, will be correct by way of following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And the internal aspect of it will be correct if it is upon ikhlas. So now listen, I want you to listen to see what happened if one of both of these are missing. The Shaykh, he says, فَمَتَى فُقِضَ الْعَمَلِ فَمَتَى فَقِضَ الْعَمَلِ أَحَدَ هَذَيْنِ الشَّرْطَيْنِ فَسَدَى. He said, and if the action is devoid of these two conditions, then it is null and void. فَمَتَى فَقِضَ الْإِخْلَاصِ. And if the ikhlas, it is missing. Or فُقِضَ إِخْلَاصِ. If the ikhlas is missing. كَانَ مُنَافِقًا. If the ikhlas is missing, right? So, out of the two conditions, accordance with the sunnah and sincerity. You take away the sincerity, but it is still in accordance to the sunnah. It's not accepted, right? Because what? The Shaykh, he says, because they're not, that's the hypocrite. Outwardly, the action is tamam. It looks good. It's according to the sunnah. But inwardly, there is no sincerity. Because you don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this likens the condition of who? Of the hypocrite. Because externally it looks good, but internally there's no ikhlas. That's like the hypocrite. So we know that. That's not going to benefit. The Shaykh, he says, وَهُمُ الَّذِينَ يُرَعُونَ النَّاسِ. They are the ones, so they do things just for the people to see them. Naam. And then he says, فَمَنْ فَقُضَ الْمُتَابَعَ. And whoever he's missing, the mutaba'a. So whoever he's missing, following. Right? He's not acting in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he is sincere. But he is sincere. Right? But is this going to benefit? He says, but I'm sincere. I'm doing it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, he is missing being in accordance to the sunnah of Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then this condition, what is this condition like? The Shaykh, he says, the Imam rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, كان ضلا جاهلا. Whoever this is his condition and he performs actions based upon this, then this individual, he is astray, and he is ignorant. This person, he is doing things upon a manner that is astray, and upon a most ignorant manner. And this is not acceptable. Who from amongst us will want to accept that he's doing that which coincides with those who are ignorant and those who are astray? Naam. Is that acceptable for anyone? Does anyone want the likes of that? No. So you realize, okay, this is not acceptable. This is not acceptable. Right? We don't want that. So the Shaykh, he says, فَمَتَى جَمَعَهُمَا كَانَ عَمِلُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. He says, and if he combines both of these aspects, then this is the actions of the believers. This is the actions of the believers. الَّذِينَ تَقَبَّلُوا عَنْهُمْ أَحْسَنَ مَا عَمِلُوا وَتَجَاوَزُوا عَنْهُمْ سَيِّئَاتِهِمْ. Those who, the best of what they used to do will be accepted, and those who their sins will be forgiven and overlooked. You see, if you want to be from those who the best of what you did was accepted and the evil that you did was forgiven and overlooked, then you have to be of those who come with what? You have to be of those who come with what? You tell me. What do you got to come with? Don't type all at once. What do you have to come with? Ikhlas wa sunnah. Naam. You have to come with ikhlas wa sunnah. You understand that? If you want that, you got to come with ikhlas and sunnah. So like we said again, this shows you, and we understand again and a little better, the repugnant nature of bid'ah. Because bid'ah is what? It jeopardizes that for us. We want the best of what we did to be accepted and our sins to be overlooked and forgiven. But bid'ah jeopardizes that. Bid'ah jeopardizes that. So anyone that will come to you with a disease like that, how evil and sick is that person? You understand what I'm saying? Because bid'ah don't walk around by itself. It's carried. It's carried. Like diseases are carried and transmitted from one who carries them. One who is infected. You understand? So a person, he's coming around you and he's affected with a worldly pathogen, right? You're gonna want to stay away from him, right? Because you don't want that. You don't want that, Yanni, having an ill effect upon your health. So you're gonna want to stay away from that particular individual. But now somebody's walking around with a pathogen that's worse than any worldly pathogen. Because now this pathogen, it is going to jeopardize your deeds being accepted and your sins being overlooked and forgiven. You can afford to get sick with that. You can afford to catch that. You understand what I'm saying? Of course, the answer is no. So therefore, if you see somebody, he coming around and he got this, now we the other way. We don't want nothing to do with you. He come, he want to talk. I don't want to hear what you got to say. He want to recite Quran. I don't want to hear you recite Quran to me. I want to recite. I don't want to hear you recite no hadith to me. I want to get away from me. Why? Because you got something that's serious. I'd rather catch any worldly pathogen than catch that. You got something serious. Get away from me. Shows you the repugnant nature of bid'ah. على كل حال. الشيخ فوزاني goes on and he says, وفي الرواية من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فهو رد. And inside of a narration, whoever introduces it is a fair of ours, that which is not from it, then it is rejected. The Shaykh, he says, فلا بد أن تكون العبادة موافقة لما جاء به الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says, so that the action, it has to conform to that which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came with. نعم. لا بإحتسانات الناس. He said, not in accordance to that which the people, they deem as being good. نعم. ومقاصدهم, and that which they intend or that which they deem. ما دام أنها لم يدل عليه. لم يدل عليها دليل من شرع فهو بدعة. He said, even though the people may have good intentions behind it and they deem it as being well and so on and so forth, as long as there is nothing that points to it, there is no proof for it from the legislation, then this affair, this action, this deed, then it is a bid'ah. The Shaykh, he says, لَا تَنْفَعْ صَاحِبُهَا. Bid'ah will not benefit its companion. It will not benefit its companion. بَلْ تَدُرُّ. But rather, it will hurt him. لِأَنَّهَا مَعْصِيَةٌ. It will hurt him because it is sin. It is sin. نعم. وَإِنْ زَعَمَ أَنَّهُ تَقَرَّبَ. أي نعم. وَزَعَمَ أَنَّهُ تَقَرَّبُ بِهَا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Even if he thinks it will get him close to Allah عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, it's sin. So therefore, the bid'ah, it won't get him close to Allah, but rather it will do what? It will take him further away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Shaykh, he says, فَلَا بُدَّ فِي الْعِبَادَةِ مِنْ هَذَيْنِ الشَّرْطَيْنِ. So that the ibadah has to have these two conditions, al-ikhlas wa mutaba'a lil-rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, حَتَّى تَكُونَ عِبَادَةً صَحِيحَةً نَافِعَةً لِصَاحِبِهَا. He said it has to have these two conditions so that the ibadah, it can be correct, it can be right, it can be beneficial to its companion. وَإِنْ دَخَلَهَا شِرْكٌ. And if shirk enters into it, then it becomes null and void. وَإِذَا صَارَتْ مُبْتَدَعَ لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ الدَّلِيلِ فَهُوَ بَاطِلٌ أَيْضًا. And if it is something that is innovated, then it has no proof for it, then it is null and void as well. دون هذين الشرطين لا فائدة من العبادة. Without these two conditions, then there is no benefit from the ibadah. There is no benefit. نعم. لأنها على غير ما شرع الله سبحانه وتعالى. Because they will be doing something that is upon other than that which Allah has legislated. والله سبحانه وتعالى لا يقبل إلا ما شرع في كتابه أو على لسان رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Allah does not accept anything except for that which he legislated inside of his book, or that which he legislated on the tongue of his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَلَا هُنَاكَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْخَلْقِ يَجِبُ اتَّبَاعُ إِلَّا الرَّسُولُ صلى الله عليه وسلم. And there's no one from the creation who it is incumbent upon us to follow them except for the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is why Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab al-Sabi حفظه الله تعالى, is why he mentioned, and he said, وغير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن طبع فيما لا دليل عليه فقد طبع بالباطل. And other than the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, if you follow someone, right, who is not the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, in that which there is no proof therein, the Shaykh, he says, then he is only being followed inside of falsehood. Inside of falsehood. Naam. Because we're only supposed to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that which agrees with what he come with. And whoever brings us something that is contrary to what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with, then we throw it away. We don't care about it. We pay it no mind. The Shaykh, he says, وَأَمَّا مَعَدَ الرَّسُولِ, and as far as other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَإِنَّهُ يُتْبَعْ وَيُطَعْ إِذَا أَتْبَعَ الرَّسُولِ. Other than the Prophet ﷺ, then that person will be followed and he will be obeyed if they follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If they follow the Messenger ﷺ, then we'll listen to what they're saying and follow what they're doing. Why? Because it coincides with the sunnah of our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. وَأَمَّا إِذَا خَالَفَ الرَّسُولِ, but if it goes against the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, it goes against the Messenger, فَلَا طَاعَ, then there is no obedience. There is no obedience. Why? Because it's going against our beloved Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. يقول الله تعالى, Allah تعالى says, أَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ وَأُولُوا أَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ, obey Allah and obey the Messenger and those who are authority over you. نعم, أُولُوا أَمْرِ هُمَ الْأُمَرَاءُ وَالْعُلَمَاءُ. And those who are authority over you, then they are the umara, they are the leaders, and they are the ulama, they are the ulama. فَإِذَا أَطَاعُ اللَّهِ وَجَبَتْ, if they obey Allah, then it becomes obligatory, then it becomes binding, as the Shaykh he says. طَاعَتُهُمْ وَاتِبَاعُهُمْ, that we have to obey them and we have to follow them. وَأَمَّا إِذَا خَالَفُوا أَمْرُ اللَّهِ, but if they go against the command of Allah, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَجُوزُ طَاعَتِهِمْ, if they go against the command of Allah, فَلَا تَجُوزُ طَاعَتُهُمْ وَلَا تَبَاعُهُمْ, then it is not permissible that we follow them, nor that we obey them, فِيمَا خَالَفُوا فِيهِ, in that affair on which they have contradicted the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم therein. لأنه ليس هناك أحد يطاع استقلا من الخلق إلا الرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, because there is no one who we will obey, نعم, unilaterally, for lack of a better term in translation, from the creation except the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. We only obey the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. There is no one who we will isolate outside of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and then we would obey and follow that particular individual. No, we follow and obey from the creation the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وما عداه فإنه يطاع ويتبع إذا أطاع الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وتبع الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Shaykh, he says, and other than him, وما عداه, other than him, other than the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, then they are obeyed and they are followed only if they obey and follow the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَهَذِهِ هِيَ الْعِبَادَةِ صَحِيحَةِ And this is the ibadah that is صَحِيحَةِ This is the ibadah that is correct. Which brings us to the next portion, in which the Shaykh, he further elaborates on the dangers of a shirk, where he says, فَإِذَا عَرَفْتَ أَنَّ الشِّرْكَ إِذَا خَالَطَ الْعِبَادَةِ أَفْسَدَهَا وَأَحْبَطَهَا وَأَحْبَطَ الْعَمَلِ And if you have known, or since you now have known, that the shirk, if it mixes with the ibadah, it destroys it, and it renders null and void the action to the end of the statement. However, we have reached the 59th minute, and now we have elapsed that minute and entered into the beginning of the next hour. So, نكتفي بهذا القدر وصلى الله عليه وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وإلا اللقاء استودعكم الله والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.